Hello and welcome. You're watching WION special broadcast, Karnataka Votes. I'm Nishchita Virendra, and today in our studio, we also have a guest joining us, Mr. Raj Shekhar, who is a senior journalist in Bengaluru, who will be joining us to decipher Prime Minister Narendra Modi's first campaign rally in the state. But before we go to him, let's quickly take a look at the speech and break it down for our viewers. So today, Prime Minister Narendra Modi launched a blistering attack against the Congress and the Gandhis in his very first rally in Karnataka. Now, his speech was also different from those given during the Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat elections. Now, both those states witnessed a highly polarized election. But in Karnataka, Prime Minister has acquired a different tune. This time, the plank is development. Now, it is personal also. It is a Rahul Gandhi versus Narendra Modi fight now. At least that's what the Prime Minister would want to pitch it as. The elections have boiled down to Kannada pride and who has done what and how much for the state. Now, his speech was much anticipated considering that he has come just about 10 days ahead of elections. Prime Minister Modi is known to change the course of elections in the past 4 years, and Gujarat is the best example in the case. It was one place where the BJP was clearly falling short of numbers, and Modi's hyper-aggressive campaigning turned around the fortunes of the party. Now, Karnataka is also fiercely independent of its identity. The issue has got politically bolstered because of the language and flag issue. It is for this very reason that the Prime Minister skipped the aggressive cultural nationalism stance in his speech. He avoided the debate completely between the state pride and an aggressive central stand on nationalism. Now, instead, he tried to create a new paradigm. So let's take a look at this short excerpt of the Prime Minister's speech from earlier today.
Congress Adhyaksh ji ne haal hi mein mujhe ek chunauti di. उन्होंने कहा अगर मैं संसद में 15 मिनट बोलूंगा तो मोदी जी बैठ भी नहीं पाएंगे. ये उन्होंने मुझे चुनौती दी है. वे 15 मिनट बोलेंगे ये भी एक बहुत बड़ी बात है. और मैं बैठ नहीं पाऊंगा ये सुनकर तो मुझे याद आता है वाह क्या सीन है. कांग्रेस के श्रीमान अध्यक्ष जी आपने सही फरमाया है. हम आपके सामने नहीं बैठ सकते. आप तो नामदार है नामदार और हम कामदारों की क्या हैसियत कि हम आपके सामने बैठ पाए. अरे आप तो नामदार हैं हम तो कामदार हैं. हम तो अच्छे कपड़े भी नहीं पहन सकते हैं. आपके सामने बैठने का हमें हक कहां पे हो सकता है. लेकिन नामदार आपकी इस बातों से मुझे चोट नहीं पहुंचती है क्योंकि हम लोगों ने सदियों से ये झेला है. नामदारों के जुल्म झेलते झेलते आए हैं और इसलिए आपकी ऐसी किसी बात से हम हताहत नहीं होते हैं. हम झेलने की ताकत बढ़ाते चले जा रहे हैं. मोदी जी को छोड़ो नामदार. इस कामदार की क्या ठीक है. हम तो है कामदार है लेकिन एक काम करो आप इस चुनाव अभियान के दरमियान कर्नाटक में आपको जो भाषा पसंद हो उस भाषा में हिंदी बोल सके तो हिंदी अंग्रेजी बोल सके तो अंग्रेजी आपकी माताजी की मातृभाषा बोल सके तो मातृभाषा आप 15 मिनट हाथ में कागज लिए बिना कर्नाटक की आपकी सरकार की अचीवमेंट सिद्धियां 15 मिनट कर्नाटक की जनता के सामने बोल दीजिए.
Well, the first half hour of the Prime Minister's speech was dedicated to Congress President Rahul Gandhi. He described Rahul Gandhi as a namdar, meaning someone who is privileged, and himself as kamdar, meaning someone whose work speaks for him. Now, the BJP is clearly trying to avoid a debate on corruption, as it feels that the Congress will further trap them on the issue. BJP's chief ministerial candidate, Yediyurappa, has spent some time behind bars, putting the party on the back foot. So then, BJP applied the offence is the best defence logic. That is one of the reasons why the attack is aimed at the Gandhi scion. We spoke to Mr. Randeep Singh Surjewala as to what is Congress's response to Prime Minister Narendra Modi's jibes, and this is what he had to say. First of all, Mr. Surjewala, it seems like Prime Minister Modi has made this entire battle of UPA versus NDA, and it's an assembly election. So your reaction to the first big rally of the Prime Minister ahead of the elections?
If I may say in Hindi, kasme kamdaron ki khate hain aur dosti daagdaron se nibhate hain. Prime Minister Modi comes to Karnataka walking on the crutches of corruption. On one side is Yedi gang, and on other side is Reddy gang. No wonder Prime Minister is acting with Shri Yediyurappa as if they are jilted lovers refusing to speak to each other on the dais. No wonder that Prime Minister Modi doesn't want to share dais with Mr. Yediyurappa. No wonder that Reddy brothers and G. Janardhan Reddy is now the chief campaign manager of BJP. No wonder that the puppet CBI has shut down 6 out of 9 cases of corruption and loot of iron ore worth 35,000 crore against Reddy brothers. And no wonder that Modi ji is relying only on Modi pops and lollipops, jumlas and diversions to pass through the short stay of 5 days that he is here. And that tells the story of a defeatist BJP and a defeated Prime Minister.
And also the Prime Minister has mocked Rahul Gandhi, the President of Congress, saying that he had challenged him for a 15-minute verbal duel in the Parliament, but he challenges him to speak for 15 minutes without using the paper and also pronounce the word Vishveshwaraya properly. So how would you react to that?
Mocking this country, mocking the people of this country, mocking the hard work and labour of this country, mocking the farmers and youth of this country has become the DNA and character of Prime Minister Modi. Sometimes he mocks the youth by saying you go and sell pakodas, that is employment. Sometimes he mocks the people by saying he will deposit 15 lakh but he will never tell them the date of deposit. Sometimes he mocks the farmer by saying he has already given cost plus 50% to them. And sometimes he mocks his political opponents, for he must realize that democracy is above mockery. Mockery may give you short brownie points with a captive crowd, but the truth will never fail. And the truth is, Modi ji is deeply unnerved and scared of what Shri Rahul Gandhi has to say about the pain and suffering of people of Karnataka.
Well, there was another interesting highlight in Prime Minister Narendra Modi's speeches. Apart from the jibes at the Congress, the Prime Minister recollected his meetings with former Prime Minister and the JDS chief, H.D. Devegowda. The Congress, on its part, has been alleging a fixed match between the JDS and the BJP in the party. But the BJP has always denied this charge, and so has the JDS. So is today's acknowledgement by the Prime Minister hinting at that very tacit understanding? Well, this is what political analysts believe.
Gain for BJP would come from Modi's image, larger than the party image, that should help them. That's what they understood, and they started projecting Modi as the face of Karnataka 2000 election for BJP. If BJP has to talk about the election the wars, then the Congress was attacking them with Reddies, and in fact they started telling Yeddi, BSY also. You know, it's like a local slang for him. You know, that's the kind of the pitch it was coming. So for BJP, it is smarter to move away from these local small issues to more this positive impact of the global leadership kind of a thing. It's the smarter thing to do. So I think, and in fact, Modi's, whenever he has done the speeches in Karnataka, we had surveyed, and people were telling, you know, they are voting for Modi than the local leaders here. So As in when Modi is coming and giving the speeches, there is a big aura and there is a big talk happening about that issue and Modi kind of the issues he is bringing in. So it will be positively definitely happening for BJP. Even Congress for that matter, it is pitching its election war with Modi than the local leaders here. I think it is looking like Siddaramaiah versus Modi. So whatever gain that BJP is expecting, it's from Modi. In fact, all the leaders were very vocal in saying that, okay, wait for February, wait for March, the Modi is to come, the Modi tsunami will work and things like that. In fact, Devegowda, when he was speaking to another national channel, you know, he was also mentioning that, okay, whatever the survey numbers you are talking today, it is based on the current situations. Modi has not yet come to Karnataka today and the dynamics will change after he start touring Karnataka. That's what even Devegowda was telling.
Well, usually it is seen that Karnataka votes against the national trend. If that is anything to go by, then BJP's hopes of taking back the state of Karnataka may be dashed. But for the Congress, it is a matter of survival as their footprint in the country is rapidly declining. The BJP has been long trying to make inroads in southern India and has not succeeded so far. If the BJP fails to win Karnataka, will their campaign of gaining relevance in South India also fail? Well, let's pose that question and much more to our guest in the studio today, Mr. Rajshekar. Thank you so much for joining us. To begin with, the Prime Minister trying to make this entire debate of UPA versus NDA. And we have seen in the last few months, the state BJP not being able to stick any accusation or any argument against the Siddaramaiah leadership. So how do you see this really panning out? Will it work for a state like Karnataka to come 10 days ahead of elections, give it a spin and say that it is about what UPA has done or what the Congress has done in the last 70 years versus what the NDA has done in the last 4 years?
We have to look at the last 3-4 elections that we have seen in the country. In these states, there is no strong regional leader as we have in Siddaramaiah here in Karnataka. That is one point. And whatever BJP tried to raise issues of religion, communalism, the saffron issues, all these things have backfired in the state. This is a typical South Indian state, not like in North India where they can whip up some emotional issues on religion and other things, or the food habits. This is not going to work. They realized it soon. And similarly, they brought in Yogi Adityanath. They said they're going to give this kind of development. But what happened in Uttar Pradesh in the last 2-3 months is an indication that they are on a back foot again. So these are the things that has pushed BJP on the back foot. So they had no idea. And also Siddaramaiah effectively countered them with regional issues. He brought in language issue. He brought in a state flag. He countered them. Some of the senior leaders in private admit that Siddaramaiah is very unpredictable and he is unconventional, and they're finding it difficult to counter him. So the soft target for BJP and the usual target is Rahul Gandhi. Mm-hmm. That's what Mr. Modi has tried to do this today. And that's a narrative that he has been telling all over the country, and he's selling that here also. As you rightly pointed out, the BJP leaders in Karnataka are themselves on a back foot because of a lot of criminal cases against them, and the chief minister candidate was in jail for a few months, and he still has that some cases pending in various courts. So this has definitely put the BJP on a back foot. So it's only the Modi that can bring in this kind of, you know, he can try to lift the BJP's prospects in Karnataka. Amit Shah has done in the last few weeks and a month, but nothing has worked for them so far.
Right. BJP is certainly pinning their hopes on Prime Minister Modi. Let's take a look at a few statistics. Now, if the BJP does not win Karnataka, it will have to face an aggressive opposition in the next round of assembly elections. Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh elections are due in December this year. Now, remember, the Congress is also very resurgent in all these three states, and they are hoping that a win in Karnataka will give them that momentum, or rather the change in momentum. But on the flip side, if the Congress loses the state of Karnataka, it will be reduced as a marginal player in Indian politics, because as of now, Karnataka is the biggest and the most prominent state that it holds. It will also weaken the Congress pitch of forming a third front to fight the BJP in the 2019 elections. Well, there you have it, why it's important for the BJP and the Congress when it comes to the Karnataka elections. And going back to the Prime Minister's speech earlier today, an issue that stood out in his Udupi speech, where he spoke about his respect for H.D. Devegowda, do you feel that it's an indication of the tacit understanding? Because it almost seemed like a force fit in that speech. You did not expect to see it coming, and all of a sudden he's talking about the immense respect he has for a veteran leader like H.D. Devegowda.
This bonhomie between Devegowda and Modi has been there for the last one and a half years. If you see in the parliament, so what happened, he took personally Devegowda and made him to sit next to him in the joint session, and we have seen that. And BJP also knows that, you know, that there is no clear trend that is emerging in Karnataka for in favor of any particular party, and JDS could be spoiler for either the Congress or the BJP too. So in that case, they don't want to burn the bridges and they want to keep it alive. And they are also talking through Yogi Adityanath to one of the prominent religious leader in Karnataka. So they're keeping the hopes alive that in case of a hung assembly, they want to join hands and they want to keep Congress away at first, because 2019 will be crucial for Modi also. And defeat here means a lot to them. And as you pointed, that various states are going, big states are going to elections, and it will be a big setback, and it will bolster Congress prospects, and also it gives them confidence that they can take on Modi and go ahead. So keeping all these options in mind, you know, BJP is keeping, and everybody is talking about it informally, formally also in Congress, I mean political circles, in media circles. It's quite evident that in case of hung assembly, they are going to go with BJP, JDS, and JDS also will weigh its options. Whoever wants to, whoever gives, whether Congress or the BJP, gives them more power, they will definitely go with them. That is the trend. But keeping the national interest, I think BJP will do whatever it can to, I mean, BJP's interest, not national interest, to do whatever it can to retain Karnataka, wrest Karnataka from Congress and face the elections on its own turf.
Lastly, just briefly, if you can tell us, do you think it was a conscious decision from the BJP to reduce the number of campaign days for the Prime Minister in the state?
I'm not sure about that, but one thing is certain. Whatever Amit Shah did in last 2-4 months in Karnataka, he has seen and he's expressed openly in public his anger and displeasure on the way the BJP Karnataka unit has functioned, and the rallies are organized. The response was quite poor for his rallies. The first one that happened on the outskirts of the city was very poorly attended. So he was not happy at all. Recently also he blasted the BJP state leaders for not organizing a proper audience appointment with one of the prominent religious heads in North Karnataka. So they have their own share of miseries, and BJP is not as united as it was when Yediyurappa came to power. There was a strong betrayal issue because of JDS not allowing him to continue his term. So that kind of strong issues are not there at all for BJP now. They cannot speak about corruption. They cannot speak about development. They cannot speak about criminal charges. They cannot speak anything on a very positive and confident note as of now. BJP is in a state of a misery in Karnataka, I can say. I mean, that's a strong word, but they're very poorly organized to face this election.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Rajshekar, for joining us and sharing your expertise with us. Well, for this very reason, the polls in Karnataka, which are due in 12 days from now, are all too important. The outcome of these elections will have a bearing on the future of all stakeholders involved. With that, we're wrapping up today's special edition. But stay tuned to WION for more news and updates. Continue on the other side.